take my picture. I look so tired today.
Ow.
Hey!
This is Christmas dinner at the Whelden house. Whoops.
Mom's eating prunes with milk.
Do, 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 do. One, two. Together they are the best.
Here we go.
She made a great impact on me because of her kindness.
Evelyn just loved people.
Always wanting to help somebody along the way.
She brought excitement to everything she did.
She just had a way of turning just a mundane experience into something fun.
She didn't need makeup.
No makeup, naturally curly hair. Athletic.
She was more interested in sports and music, and dating was sort of, you know, I'll do that later.
She was honest, and she was just all wool the yard wide.
Hi, folks. I want to tell you about my mom, Evelyn, mainly through the voices of others who knew her. We all agree the word that describes her best is self-sacrifice. The Bible puts it this way, greater love hath no man than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. That's what Mom did, starting when she was young with her brother Emerson, then as a teacher for the handicapped. During World War II, as a Red Cross worker overseas, as a piano teacher for hundreds of students in Canton, Pennsylvania, but ultimately as the best mom we could ever hope for, Roxanne, Roy, and me, Lynn. And yet, the special path, the narrow gate that Mom chose to follow did not make sense to many people. With that in mind, let's begin at the end of the story. It's a beautiful June afternoon in the Canton neighborhood. Mom decides to go into the 100-year-old barn behind her house. She climbs the rickety stairs to the second floor, where, years earlier, Roy and I had built a tennis wall. Somehow Mom doesn't see a rotten floorboard and crashes onto the cement floor below. She cannot call for help because broken ribs have pierced and deflated her lung. A neighbor eventually notices. Mom is life-flighted to the closest intensive care unit and put on a ventilator. On day 49, the hospital decides to pull the plug. 72 hours later, Mom passes on. In 1917, Mom was born in the same house, in this second-floor room. The ceiling plaster fell down later that day. In 1923, her brother Emerson was born following a 2-week labor. The umbilical cord was wrapped around his neck. Low oxygen to the brain resulted in cerebral palsy.
Sandy hair. And very, very delicate features. He was a nice-looking little boy, but he couldn't hold his head up. He couldn't sit up or anything.
Beautiful boy, but so big. And her mother would sit there holding him on her lap and feeding him. He had to be fed and diapered and treated like a little baby, but here he was, this older child.
I'd hold him at the piano, playing. And that book is upstairs. All those little old-fashioned songs you sing for little kids. And I'd hold him in my lap and sing it. And then when Mommy would have him, giving him an enema or something, you know, I could sit down at the piano and I'd play, oh, just a few notes of it, you know, and I'd call out, is it this or that? I'd purposely name several different kinds. And when I'd name the correct one, he'd kick his little leg and smile.
She loved him so. That brother, oh, she loved him so.
He had to carry this little fellow around, and he would be usually wrapped in kind of like a blanket. He would be dressed.
Took him all around the neighborhood. And she was so kind and attentive to him, so compassionate.
But never a word of complaint. Never a word of complaint.
And I remember when he died, the Merritts wanted him buried in Canton.
So they had him embalmed, put him in the casket, and they had a carrier on the back end of their car.
And there was an accident, and the casket fell off the car.
It got sideswiped, I think. And they sent a telegram, they were delayed a day. Both Annie and Uncle Lynn and my dad had to all chip in to pay for the undertaker. All three of them. That's how tight money was.
We lived across the street from the Merritts, and that we, Evie and I, were 11 years old, and we became fast friends, just inseparable. We would give plays and charge a penny or a pin, and we would act in my parents' garage and put the seats out in the driveway. And Evie really composed those. She made them up.
Oh, your mother used to tell Claire a nice story. Oh, Black Hand, she called him, and Red Hand. She always spun some kind of a story. But she'd make them up as they go along. Fact is, it made them so real that Claire and I start crying. I tell you.
Another thing we used to do, we had a little school in her basement, and we had some little kids come in, and we taught them how to read, or we thought we did.
Life was wonderful in that lovely, lovely town of Canton, and Evelyn was there in the summertime.
She'd come and stay the summers and supposed to help Grandma, which she never did. She was always doing something, hiking or swimming. And she was a good-looking girl. She had a lot of boyfriends. Bill Hallett, he had a car. Another one of her boyfriends, I think, was Art Marvin, lived next door.
Once I'd come, you know, the guys would be on the phone, Art Marvin and Bill Hallett and everything, you know, call me all the time. And the last time, I think it was, I came, I told Grandma, I said, I'm not going to be on that phone so much. I said, I feel guilty. I want to spend more time with you than with these boys. And she said, no. She says, you just have a good time and you just talk on the phone and go with those boys all you want.
Well, he was bigger than I, a heavy fella, athletic, and, well, he dated your mother, I think it was about the same time I was, a little bit later maybe, and I wasn't too pleased with that.
Art Marvin, I think, was the boy that Evelyn liked the most, because he was a wonderful swimmer. And she had a hard time finding boys that could match her skills in the sport arena. But Art could.
Hiking up around the cliffs, I was always the first one to crawl in the holes, and down the alleys and up and stairs. The Devil's Staircase. Went up between two ledge, cedar ledge rocks.
And that was one of Evelyn's greatest joys, was hiking the hills. And we did a lot of that. We went to Cedar Ledge once. That was, once was enough, because we hiked to the top with our lunch with no matches. She was more athletic than anybody I knew. She had more stamina. So she'd head out and we'd be kind of trailing along behind her. And she was the first to reach the ledge, I'm sure. But she was never critical of the laggers.
And we played, oh, on that porch. When the big porch was all the way around, oh, we had wonderful time on the porch. Your mother would think up games. She was very good on thinking up games to do for us.
When I first met Evelyn, I knew she was musical because I'd heard her play the piano, and I knew she was very good. And I was a violin player, but just mediocre. And one day Evelyn said, well, I have some music here, and it has a violin part, and would you like to play it and I'll accompany you? And I said, oh, I'd love it. Well, when she started to play, I knew I was no match for her, but it started a fun thing for us to do summers, because she came many summers during our high school days.
Do you remember when you and my mom, Evelyn, roller skated across the bridge?
Yeah. That was fun. Oh, it was fun. And we were always looking for unusual adventures in Detroit City.
We graduated in 1934 in the middle of the Depression.
Having just turned 17, Mom decided to attend nearby Wayne University, majoring in music.
We used to walk from Wayne University down Woodward Avenue to the orchestra hall. And we did this once a week. And on this one Saturday, a very famous conductor was there. And we both had flowers to take up afterward, to carry big bouquets of flowers. And Evelyn was so excited that she took hers up and handed it to the gentleman and almost made a bow. She was thinking, you know, that she just had to be part of that. The thing that really sold me on Evelyn as a musician is when she played in her recital. She played the Moonlight Sonata, and I just could not believe it. It was just fascinating. She was so powerful and with a lot of expression, feeling.
She always played with such expression. I do remember that. She really was a marvelous musician.
Well, back in those days, you just didn't do things with Negroes, and they went their own way. But Evelyn made a very special effort. I think it was probably in her French class, but she got to know this man, and she really liked him, and they danced together, and she thought it was just great. And it was a big story then, a really big story.
An additional year at Wayne qualified Mom to teach handicapped, crippled kids.
I'd bring my girlfriends from Detroit. I wanted them to meet Grandma, to meet Andy. Eleanor, you know, was sitting on that rock outside that waterfall. First time she'd ever been to a place like this, but we drove her here and brought her here.
On one of the visits to Canton, we traveled to the, well, this would have been a waterfall.
Your mother got wanted to go up there, so she conned me in going with them, she and her girlfriend from Detroit. And they, I don't know whose camera it was. I think it might have been my brother's camera I took that picture with.
We got just a snap of it. We liked it. So then I think we went ahead and had some photographer color it.
Helen Dewey tinted them with the watercolors.
We each had a picture of that, and we've had it for years and years and years. I still have mine on my wall.
Mr. Lemmer was the superintendent of schools, and he hired both of us in the same year, and we had never taught before. And he just thought we'd make good friends, so he called us into his office and introduced us. And we were good friends after that. We got acquainted, and we found out that we lived in the same area of town, so we just decided it would be nice to live together. And she had a room up on the second floor with her handicapped children, and I taught junior business training and arithmetic in the junior high building. Her office was, or her place was in the junior high building. Most of the people that we knew were musicians. Ross was a music teacher, Gertie was a music teacher, and Evelyn used to sing. Charlie was a sports editor for the local paper, and he roomed with Ross, and Ross was a music teacher in the junior high school. So it was through our teaching connections that we were met. And Charlie used to take us for a ride in his car. And we used to go around to the basketball games because he had to cover those for his sports editorship. She liked sports so much, and she loved her sleeping bag, and she just liked to be outdoors. And she would go down on the beach at night and take her sleeping bag and sleep down there.
I would always want the windows open all year round, and she got so she couldn't stand it in the winter, so I slept on the couch in the living room and opened the window in the living room.
She was out skiing a lot with Rico Zenti. I don't think she was ever engaged to him. I think they were just both like sports, and they used to just enjoy the skiing. She just liked to hike, and she just liked nature, and she used to like to just get out and get the fresh air. And she was just a good sport. She was a wonderful roommate and a wonderful friend.
In 1940, Mom's parents ran a boarding house for college students in Ann Arbor, Michigan. Mom was still teaching physically handicapped kids in Escanaba. On one of her visits to the house, she brought her best friend Jerry along.
Evelyn came to the house one time and said, "I have a friend that I'd like you to meet who's all wool and a yard wide." This is a saying that the older seamstress has used for very good yard goods for making clothes. And she said, "I'm going to bring Jerry up to have up with me sometime and meet." So coming home from Christmas vacation, and this was in January of 1941. I arrived at the Merritts, and there was no bedding. Ma Merritt had taken it out for laundry and also had loaned some of the mattresses to a friend for a Christmas family gathering. So about 9 o'clock, the Merritts showed up with Evie and Jerry in tow. And it was about 9 o'clock that night, and I'd been up the night before on the train ride, and I was tired and anxious to go to bed, but I somehow was managed to stay awake till about 2:30 in the morning. The next day we'd had a heavy snowfall, and we romped around in the snow with Evie and one of the boys in the house, Woody Williamson, and then we'd planned a long hike. I think that was the first day of our date, or perhaps the second. It was a weekend. We walked, I don't know, over 15 miles out into the north of Ann Arbor, out into the countryside, and then sort of hitchhiked a little bit on the way back. And that was it. That was it. We were hooked.
And they ended up getting married. Now that guy there, let's see. We went on. He was a forester major, like Claire, you know, my brother was. And I went on a hike with him one day. We hadn't known each other very long, and I can still remember. We were hiking, we were hanging around by a tree, and he asked me to marry him. And I didn't know him that well. And he felt so hurt when I had become. He thought we'd make a good pair, he said, because we were like the out of doors and everything. But I somehow had the idea that I had to know somebody for a long, long time.
I got to know Jerry Irie, and she and Evie were close friends. So the three of us did things together. One of the memories I have is that Evie and Jerry wanted me to try horseback riding because they enjoyed it and they thought I'd enjoy it. And we had done some hiking and things like that together. And so we went out to a riding stable, and the man who was in charge of the stable would not allow these two young women to take me on a horse out of the corral, because obviously I didn't know what I was doing. And they were sure that the horse would go along with their horses and that everything would be fine, but he said, no, no. So he walked my horse around the corral during the period of time that they went for their ride with me on it, me on the horse. And that was my one and only experience with horseback riding.
Your mother was an active member of the Methodist Church in Redford, as well as Ruth Ballou.
I knew her through the church group, and then I knew her in high school. I think she played on the hockey team. She was in one of the sports groups. Then I got better acquainted when we went to college. We both went to Wayne State University.
Ruth decided that she wanted to travel, but she didn't have much money. She'd bought a new car, a new Ford. Paid $750 for it.
I had the car in the summer and got together a group, and there were five of us. We started west. Evelyn was going to stay in Colorado because she wanted to study mountain climbing there. The rest of us were just out exploring. And the gals were from different friends of mine, but none of them knew each other. They all got very well acquainted. We left Evelyn after we were in Colorado and went on toured a lot of the West. But while we were in Colorado, we decided to go horseback riding at the Brockhurst Ranch. And we did pretty well until a hailstorm came along, and then we were drenched.
It was so muddy on this trail and slippery, and we were just drenched and our feet were covered with mud. We got back to the ranch house and this guide said, "You look awful. I'm going to take your picture." So that was it, with our hair hanging in strings and our clothes soaked. So we took this picture, which we treasured later.
We later left Evelyn. She went to school at Boulder, I think it was.
Dropped her off at this fraternity house at Boulder.
That's the Colorado University where I stayed in the summer. See, somebody had suggested a nice vacation, just enroll in a summer school out west, and that's cheap enough, and then you can have your whole summer vacation out there. I took horseback riding as a course, joined the Mountain Recreation Club. Apache Peak was up in here somewhere. We hiked along there and went up the rocks. There we are hiking along. This is where we were supposed to go, and it was all a safe enough place for us to climb, and here we are up on the top. Just as soon as we finished this, came way down the bottom, they took us right across here. The rock was straight up and down over here, and we had to rappel down. That night, we had slept high up on the mountain, camping out, you know. And it had made me a little bit mountain sick, a little bit dizzy-like, a little bit nauseated-like. So I didn't feel like eating any breakfast. And you're not supposed to eat on your way up. That was supposed to be one of the rules. But I had some raisins in my pocket. And I can remember when we sat down there for a break that I ate the raisins. And the raisins gave me the strength. That's That's all I'd eaten, to go all the way up this high mountain. And then, it was the last day, and the girls were going to pick me up. Ricky, Malou, you know, they were coming back from California, those girls you saw in the other picture. And it so happened that I had just met this guy, and he and I had made an appointment to play tennis that very afternoon. The girls were coming by, or maybe it was the morning, I don't know. But anyway, the girls arrived, and they were so kind. They said, oh, they'll just rest in the dorm on the bed, and you go out and play tennis. So I went out and played tennis with this guy.
She was saying, oh, I love to play tennis. I love to just get up a sweat and then go take a shower. And I thought, get up a sweat? That's the last thing I want to do.
Picked her up on the way back after we'd been through most of the West.
On the way home, we had a flat tire. And Ricky Blue is so capable. She can do anything. This was her car. And here she is changing the flat tire and the rest of us lying around resting.
Your mom wanted to stretch and so forth, and she got out. She had on skirt and blouse at the time. And she got out and turned a few cartwheels, and these local yokels were looking at her because, of course, her underpants showed, but they were very proper white cotton underpants. We all giggled about that.
During that summer of 1941, my mom attempted to climb Long's Peak. You can see it in the middle of those three peaks there. 14,255 feet. And the story is she did it on nothing more than one box of raisins. So today, 63 years later, I'm going to try to do the same thing.
I'm at the keyhole, 12,800 feet. The altitude is starting to have its effect now. I'm getting very tired and taking a lot more time to walk on these boulders.
I've decided to head back. I'm about 100 yards beyond the keyhole, but the trail is still full of ice and snow. From here on up, it's a technical climb until the middle of July when everything melts, but that's a month from today. So I'll have to come back another time, and I never did break into the box of raisins.
Look and listen very closely, because this is the only video ever shot of Roy Whelden.
How often have you been on video?
Never.
This is your first time? This is your debut?
I guess so. I don't ever remember being on it. Help. Why, am I supposed to be different?
No, actually, you're acting like a movie star. So relaxed and
acting like some kind of a moron. Be the subject of somebody's thesis.
In 1941, Roy was a New Hampshire college student dating Edna Twombly, a native of Alton, New Hampshire. She was on track to become a teacher. The Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor in December of 1941, killing 2,400 Americans and dragging the United States into World War II. When the draft called Roy up the following year, he gave Edna an engagement ring before heading off to Fort Jackson, South Carolina.
It was wartime, and I didn't see him too much, but whenever he came home, we did things together and thought we were going to be serious about things.
Roy's childhood was a troubled one. His older sister left home as soon as she could. Roy couldn't live up to the expectations of his Harvard-educated father, Roy Sr., a renowned biologist. His home was filled with many ant farms, the subject of almost a dozen peer-reviewed research papers. When Roy was 10 years old, his father requested that he be taken out of public school. The superintendent granted the request, noting that Roy was not physically able to attend school due to his difficulties. In fact, he had developed a nervous tic due to social anxiety. He didn't return until the following year. He related to animals and the outdoors best.
Being the loner, you know, he was such a loner, go off by himself. And he would have been happy, really, all by himself.
I remember your grandma told me once that when they'd move to a new town or something. Anyway, they were calling him mentally retarded or something. They were putting him in a low class. But he was shy or bashful or something.
During school recess, Roy would be all alone. Frustration expressed itself through a temper, like when he was pitching for a baseball team and he threw the ball at the crowd. He became guarded and private, as co-worker Abby Cooper noted many years later.
He was so private that even his cronies in Alton, I mean, he had a couple of guys, I know, that he would go up and, I don't know, old friends, probably, but it was like he would never even say their names. I'm going to Alton to see my friend, not I'm going off to see Frank.
The Army gave him psychological tests and determined he was not combat material. So he served stateside with the military police, delivering paperwork in Florida and guarding railroad bridges in Texas.
He did buy me a nice ring, and I wore that for a while. He was still in the service, and I was teaching in Ashland, I think, then. And we still were engaged when I moved to Lebanon.
At the same time, Mom put her teaching on hold to join the Red Cross. Her friend Lois Cimarol explains.
We were all wanting to do our very best at what we could do to support our country. And an ad came in the paper that they were looking for Red Cross workers to serve in the European and South Pacific fields. And I was very interested in maybe helping a little more than I already was. So I interviewed for the job and was able to take it.
As soon as the school year was over, Mom began intensive training. She's reading from letters she had written to her parents.
Fort Meade, that would be Fort Meade, Maryland. Army marches. We had to go out and march around like an army. Bivouacs, infiltration, and so forth.
Mary Jane Pinto was a nurse preparing for the same mission.
We had training as far as marching, obeying orders, going through the gas chamber, and going on the infiltration course.
Is that where they
fired live bullets at you and you had to crawl on the ground?
Mm-hmm. I don't know if they were live or not. They told us they were.
Mm-hmm. And then, though I would have liked to have gone perhaps to Europe, they sent me back across the country to the Pacific.
When they finally thought we were ready to go, that's when we went by train all the way across the United States. It took a whole week, and that's when I sat up in the caboose in the back, strumming on that ukulele, you know, three chords I'd learned. And the doctors and most of them would sit on the floor and sing all day long.
There were servicemen aboard. They were sometimes up in the rafters, so to speak. We were not to call at any of our stops, not to call home to say where we were going. It was a crowded train, but we made the journey fine.
Once the train reached San Francisco, the next leg of the journey was a two-week ocean crossing.
This had been a cruise ship.
We had a ship that normally had about 1,200 people, and we had 16,000 on the ship. So we were crowded.
The crossing on the boat was some experience. I still don't know what kept me from jumping overboard for the first week and a half. There is nothing absolutely to compare with seasickness. I have never been so miserable in my life. The biggest day on the boat was the day that we crossed the equator.
They'd throw them in the pool and when we crossed the equator, but I steered clear of that. You gotta not get your hair wet, you know? Gotta take care of your hair. You're gonna be a long way from a beauty shop.
All of us polywogs were put through a huge initiation, blindfolded, crawling on hands and knees, whipped with wet rags, eggs, mustard, and grease thrown on us, hair cut, ether put in our mouth, and finally thrown in a tub of salt water. We then emerged as shellbacks and were presented with a certificate. Fun. Oh boy, I loved it.
In November of 1943, the boat arrived at the port of Noumea on the South Pacific island of New Caledonia. Mom was one of just two Red Cross recreation workers assigned to the sprawling 29th General Hospital, handling over 1,000 patients.
18 of us are living in a barracks room. We have clothes and trunks and barracks bags all over the place. But it doesn't bother my messy nature at all. In wet weather, the floors are caked with mud. And speaking of wet weather, we're really in for some rain. Is it ever fun to just wade right through 6-inch mud and know that that's just what you're supposed to do? We all dress in slacks and old shoes. When we wash clothes, we just hang them up to dry and put them right back on again.
We had a real fine outfit. We had just 45 doctors, most of them from the faculty of the University of Colorado, the volunteer faculty. And we went to New Caledonia and established a hospital. My job then, I was chief of gastroenterology in the hospital. And again, the nurse on my floor was Mary Jane. By then she was Pinto, she had married. And we had a real good service. We took care of the casualties and the sick people from battles like New Georgia and Guadalcanal and many of the invading islands in the South Pacific.
My job was that of an able-bodied recreation worker, which meant that I worked in a Red Cross service club. All of a sudden thought perhaps I could be of a little more help if I were in a hospital unit. And so I joined one and was sent to New Caledonia, to the 29th General Hospital.
New Caledonia was a staging area for Army, Navy, Marines, and was a very busy place. I think at one time we had 200,000 troops.
I only had the power of relaxation. I have a couple hours off this morning because I'm working all day and evening And I'm just laying in bed thinking of the music appreciation discussion I just started last night, of other discussion groups I want to start, of the music on the wards tonight, of the birthday party tomorrow night, of the Dramatics Club next week, of the radio plays we want to put on, of the quiz program and game parties I want to have in the wards, of what in the dickens can I give the bed patients to do now that our craft supplies are almost gone, and so forth, so forth, so forth.
I probably saw more, maybe, dysentery than any doctor in the world at that time, because the Japanese, when they'd leave an island, they had a lot of people that were sick, and they knew they were sick with amoeba. They would contaminate all the wells with amoeba, and these people would come in pretty sick with amoeba diarrhea, and our wards were pretty full all the time with that. Of course, because of that, we had a lot of hepatitis too. The antibiotics had just become available, penicillin, and we didn't have much in the way of antibiotics except for penicillin, and then we could only use very small doses because it was not available, not a lot of it available.
Holiday season for Red Cross workers, enough to age you 10 years. For the last 3 days, I have taken off enough time to eat lunch and supper, and that's all. I don't even go home to the barracks till about 10 at night or later. I'm rehearsing the Glee Club, church choir, quartet, women's voices, directing three-act play for drama club, and the melodrama for the patients. Helped wrap Christmas packages the other night for the patients, Red Cross gifts, after 10 o'clock when through with play rehearsal. The other girls are getting the building decorated, getting the special programs and favors made and colored, and we're all making plans for the party and trying to carry on our regular routine work at the same time.
Well, in the hospital, we wrote letters. A lot of the fellows were not able to write themselves, and we would write for them. We were trying to be good listeners because these were all fellows that were lying in bed with injuries. We heard many stories of their homesickness and tales of woe of a Dear John letters. So our interest was in raising their morale as much as we could.
How did you meet my mom, or what do you recall about my mom, Evelyn?
Well, we were, of course, working in the same unit. We were the same level of occupation. She had, of course, been there quite a while. I remember her as a very natural-looking lady. I don't believe she wore any makeup. She had this lovely black hair and just a very natural kind of person. On some of the days when we had time off, we would hike, bushwhack through the surrounding territory, and sometimes find a invigorating pool of water.
We rehearse 3 nights a week, Dramatics Club the 4th, work at Red Cross the 5th, Men's Glee Club the 6th. I have one night to call my own, in which I can have more time to practice the play.
It was I don't know. It was just a wonderful thing to do. A big part of my life. I wish people today would have the same feeling.
Hmm. You mean the same feeling about what you...
Of wanting to help.
For some reason or other, I have a strange loyalty to this job. I seem to feel that every mother is depending on me personally to make her boy a little happier. I don't know why I feel that so strongly. Maybe because I've got brothers and cousins and friends I love all in the service.
In a letter dated February 26, 1945, Mom delivers a bombshell to the folks back home regarding a Captain Charles B. Hall.
I went out with him yesterday for the first time, and I do believe I'm in love. Really, this is a silly thing to say. I'm half kidding. Of course, knowing me, I may dislike him in a couple of days, but let me tell you about him now while my impressions are favorable. Very athletic. Played football and basketball in college. Loves tennis, swimming, hiking, anything in the outdoors, especially winter sports. Has never even tasted liquor in his life. Don't think he's kidding me. Smokes a little, and when I told him I didn't like it, he immediately said, okay, I don't smoke, and threw his cigarette away.
6 months later, another bombshell letter.
If no chair is handy, then find one and sit down. Your daughter has some rather unusual news to spill. Yesterday I received a letter from Chuck written from his home, and now I find it's my turn. I've seen it happen to other girls so often that I had built up inside of me a nice little defense mechanism that is holding me in good stead right now. He tells me that he believes he's in love with his old girlfriend and doesn't love me anymore. He says he is miserable and unhappy because he feels he is a heel. He is not quite sure just what the score is. I've taken it very well because I have so wanted to be sure that this was the real thing, and I guess that it wasn't. The only thing that hits one between the eyes is to read the unbelievably wonderful love letters that he wrote me. Oh well, I really can understand it perfectly. I know that if I had come home first and had seen Rico, if I didn't keep telling myself that I mustn't do it, I probably would have fallen for him all over again. The only angle to this deal that wasn't very fair on Chuck's part was that he had led me to believe, without actually saying so in exact words, that he had written to her about me. He said he was going to do it, and then talked as if I was surely the only one he cared about. On the strength of that, I wrote to Rico, though it took an awful lot of willpower to do it. As a consequence, Rico is now married. Oh, well, again, that wasn't meant to be either.
Then the war ended, and he came home, and we couldn't seem to agree on things. He couldn't decide what he was going to do, and he wasn't one to talk things over or confide very much, and so I didn't know what he was going to do, and of course I was already established teaching by then, so I gave him the ring back.
She had goals for him, and he wouldn't talk about it, and she realized at that point that he was doing this before, and she did not want to marry him because he would not talk about any goals. He refused to talk about what he was going to do in life.
Meanwhile, a boat is crossing the Pacific Ocean.
We wanted to be home by Christmas. I think we arrived in San Francisco early in December. But because we could, for the same price, take a roundabout way, we chose to do so. I think it must have been Yosemite. We spent a couple days in a cabin, and then we went on down to, well, I don't know if it was L.A. or San Diego, where Evelyn left us.
Yeah, I can remember. My folks drove all the way from Detroit out there with nice skis in the car. And I've got those photographs, skiing out there and falling down.
I also had a call from your mom. She was in the East, and she wanted to look for a teaching position. And she asked if I would bring her mother and my mother and use her father's car and come East. And we did that, and we had a nice trip together. Our mothers were both good friends, and we got along well. We picked up Evelyn, and we traveled through New England looking at ski areas. And if she liked the looks of it, then she might apply for a job. She finally found just the place she wanted to be. And she applied for a job and got it.
Mom got a teaching job in the small town of Alton, New Hampshire. The school was small, too. The elementary grades were on the first floor, and all the other grades upstairs. Mom taught sixth grade and high school chorus. Joyce Dorr and George Wigan were in Mom's class.
She was the best teacher we ever had. We loved her. She was patient, she was kind, and she was just a great teacher.
You know, you think about people and how they influenced your life. Well, she was the one that influenced mine the most, I think. Well, I was, 12 years old. She lived five houses from me. cars. And the only way to get to school was to walk, and it was a mile each way. And then I would wait after school till she was done with whatever she was doing, and then she'd walk home, and I'd walk home with her. And we talked a lot. And she gave me a lot of good information that I couldn't have gotten from anywhere else. And she really helped me. I appreciated her.
When Mom first came to town, she was living in an unheated room at the Alton Hotel. Another teacher lived just down the hallway in a heated room, Ella Marie Nourse. She was dating Robert Carr, who was best friends with Roy Whelden. It was Ella Marie that introduced Roy to Miss Merritt.
Yeah, that's where my romance started. I loved to ski, and I loved to try to learn to ski, and he was a great skier. I thought we had a lot of things in common. He didn't drink, he didn't smoke, he loved to play tennis, he loved to ski. He was very musical. Wow, your daddy was musical. He had a beautiful voice. And he had all those recordings of all the operas and everything, and he could just hear some melody from an opera, and he'd immediately know who it was, who wrote it, and who that was. And we even would go down to Boston to opera sometimes. I thought your dad was highly intelligent, and I have always thought that he was.
The urge to create families was very, very strong. I think because everyone realized that's what really life is all about, and let's get on with it, let's do it. And marriage was very, very important then.
Back then, it was after World War II, and there was a thing in the atmosphere that you had to get married, and they were both under that spell. And it seems like he gave a ring before they knew each other 2 weeks.
It was hard for Mom to think clearly.
I was 30 years old and thought you had to get married.
And then Roy Sr. makes a depressing observation.
Your Grandpa Whelden was, I can remember he was lying down on the couch in the room next to the kitchen, and I was telling my mother-in-law and him that we were going to get married. And I was walking into the room, and he said, "Are you sure you want to marry him? He can't lead, and he refuses to follow." That's the way he put it. He was right.
My sister, my older sister, played the organ and piano and so forth, and she played for the church choir and church services. But when Evelyn came, she took over that. Marguerite wanted to give it up. And Evelyn was a musician, and so she played the organ for the church. And one Sunday, Marguerite called me and said that she had to go to church to play the organ for Evelyn, because Evelyn had climbed Mount Washington the day before, and she was so lame and tired out that she really didn't want to get to church that day. And I heard afterwards, or maybe Roy told me sometime, that they did climb Mount Washington, and he took her up the trail. It's called Huntington Ravine Trail. It's one of the steepest and most difficult ones, because he'd taken me up that way one time, and I know what it was. So they had gone up that trail, and that was what had lamed her up for a Sunday service.
Less than a year after they first met, the wedding date is set. Mom goes back to Detroit for a bridal shower. Jerry, Ruth, Fran, and Fern are there. The day of the wedding, a huge forest fire shuts down major roads. With great difficulty, they finally make it to the Methodist Church in Kittery, Maine. No one from Roy's side of the family shows up. Mom's parents are the only witnesses. To mark the occasion, they go to Warren's Lobster House. There's a short honeymoon to Niagara Falls. And then it's back to his parents' house in New Durham, New Hampshire.
Yeah, because he didn't have a job, he didn't have any money, we didn't have any house to live in. So we slept up in the top of the barn for our bedroom.
So you guys started living in the barn in October in New Hampshire. That was cold.
Oh, yeah. Who cares? I mean, I was always cold-blooded, you know, and I always would insist on having the windows open all year round.
Roy went back to the University of New Hampshire to pick up where he left off before the war. Mom got a job at their radio station writing scripts. That's where they recorded this duet, Indian Love Call, with Mom on piano. Finally graduated with a degree in geology and landed a job with the government.
And so they assigned us down there to New Mexico, Albuquerque, New Mexico. And that would be when the spring came along in the summer, because it was so hot down there that we couldn't stand it. We bought this secondhand cots from the army stores, and we'd go up in the top of the, we'd climb up a hill and sleep up there where it'd be cooler. And by that time I'd started to be pregnant with Sissy, and we'd go to the movies at night to cool off, and then when we'd come out from the movies I'd go and vomit under the street, and I couldn't stand it. And I had said, couldn't he ask for a job with the government to be sent north? Now here's where I feel a little guilty. They did say he could go to Ohio, and I said, oh, Ohio's not an interesting state, let's not go there. So that's when he got the job with the Anaconda Copper Mining Company out in Montana, and I thought, oh, that'd be great.
My husband was working on his doctorate at Denver University. And surprisingly, one day, Evelyn and her husband, Roy, showed up to visit us. And that was really great. We lived in a tiny, tiny apartment. You could barely, you'd turn around and you'd bump into the refrigerator or something. But we had a good visit there. But I was amazed to find out that she was climbing mountains. I couldn't believe it. And she said she was pregnant. I thought, well, okay, I guess she knows what she can do. I don't know where Roy was. He must have been there somewhere. But the only time that I really got to know them as a couple was when they came to visit my apartment. That was when I lived in Detroit. This was earlier. And I had them over for dinner one time. And I sensed that day that Roy wasn't real happy about the way things were going. Something, he made a comment about, I wish my wife would serve dinner like this, or, you know, something like that. He didn't much care for the fact that she didn't like cooking.
So we went out there, and that's where Sissy was born. And then after 6 months out there, he lost the job.
But I remember Roxanne being such a pretty little girl with long curls.
Roxanne is a very bright little girl and just full of life. And she could play the piano.
Sissy was so exceptionally bright when she was so little. Playing the piano all the time, and finally on her fifth birthday, I gave her the book and we had a little lesson every day, and she went right through the book.
She and I corresponded like once every 3 or 4 months we might write. And that went on until you two boys had been born, and she had come to Detroit to visit her parents with your children. And that was the summer that was so tragic for Roxanne.
Your daddy offered to take me to Detroit for a little vacation. He thought, you know, you knew I liked to go and see the folks.
He wanted a vacation without us kids along, but Mom's will prevailed.
So he took all of us back there. I've even got pictures of girlfriend Jerry and her kids about your same age, you know, standing out in the lawn. And that's where Sissy got the mumps.
Your mother said she had taken you children to the mother and daughter banquet at church. And she said it was fine, except you must have been exposed to the mumps there because you all came down with the mumps. And she said, I'll let you know when we're over. Well, she called a couple weeks later and said, I guess we're through the mumps now. She said, Roxanne has a stiff neck, though. And I had been reading about mumps in my Dr. Spock book. And I said, Evie, you got a Dr. Spock? She said, no. And I said, well, let me read what he says about a stiff neck following mumps. And I said, I read the paragraph to her from the book. And so she promptly took Roxanne to the physician, and he diagnosed meningitis, put her in the hospital. And this very tragic time followed.
Roxanne had been rushed by ambulance to Henry Ford Hospital, where she spent 7 days. A painful spinal tap confirmed the meningitis diagnosis. Upon release, we returned to New Hampshire by way of Niagara Falls. 6 weeks later, without any warning, Roxanne slipped into a coma. For 6 long, depressing weeks, she lay in bed in Portsmouth Hospital. When she finally came home, her speech was gone and her right arm and right leg were paralyzed, but her intelligence was still intact.
She felt a deep sense of guilt, I'm sure, because your father had not wanted her to come. And she told me that. She said, how am I going to explain this? Because he didn't want me to bring the children. So it bothered her terribly at that time, I'm sure.
I would take her to a therapist every single week, and they taught me how to do all the things. And she didn't use her intelligence at all. And I taught her to type with her left hand on the typewriter and all that stuff. And she began to get some language back. And that went on for 3 years. I can remember I'd even take her to church. We'd go to church.
3 years later, 9-year-old Roxanne got measles. Once again, the virus penetrated the blood-brain barrier, resulting in encephalitis.
The doctor said, as we walked in there, he was a young doctor, I think, one of the new ones working, and he said, don't worry, we'll have her all well again when you go out, you know. And so, and I'd always insist on staying right by her bed day and night. Finally, they made me go to, they said, we've got a vacant room down there and you've got to go down there and get some sleep. So I went down there and I started to cry. I hadn't cried before, I knew I didn't dare you. And I'll never forget, it just wrecked me apart, and they heard me all over the hospital. So the doctor told me the next day that they all heard me crying, and I just would have to leave at night and get some sleep. So our friends lived in that same town. So every night about midnight, I'd go down there and sleep.
The brain damage was so severe, all mental capacity was wiped out. She lost all speech. She couldn't walk by herself or feed herself. She had to wear diapers. The daily grand mal seizures were controlled by Dilantin, which caused swollen gums and facial hair. Almost overnight, Roxanne had become a bedridden invalid. Roxanne's illness took its toll on the marriage.
He got so he never came home until late at night. And he'd always say that he was with his lawyer friend doing the stamp business. Your dad had that bedroom. We had one bedroom downstairs. And he always used that bedroom to sleep in. And he had all his stamps in there and everything, you know. And I'd have to pick Sissy up and carry her upstairs, where we'd go to bed up there. And I'd ask him if he wouldn't trade rooms with me so I didn't have to carry her up. He wouldn't pay any attention. So once when Poppy and Greggy were there, Daddy and I decided we would move his stuff up for him. So we just very neatly took all his stamp stuff and put it up in the bedroom and fixed his bed upstairs. And then when he came home that night, I said, well, your bedroom's upstairs now. So Sissy and I can sleep down here and I don't have to carry upstairs. Well, it was shortly after that that he got so mad. He told me he hated me. I must have done something wrong. I despise you. I hate you. And he's going to leave, you know. So I can remember walking down that long road to the main dirt road there, you know, and I put my arm around him and I just said, I still love you. I don't hate you. You can come back anytime you want to. I just went back in the house, went upstairs, and Pop was lying in it. Bedroom back there that was big. I could pop up there and drag you over there. And I just walked in and I said, told Pop that Roy's gone, he's left me. And Daddy just started to giggle, to laugh a little bit, you know, as if he just couldn't believe the story. They immediately left when your dad went off. Like the very next day. And I'm sure that they had the idea that he'd probably come back when they got out of the way. And so they left, but he never came back. And so eventually they came back to help me. He'd been gone a couple weeks, and I didn't know what in the dickens to say to you, and I kept hoping he'd come back. And one day, Freddie said to me, where's Daddy? I haven't seen him in a long time. So I thought, well, now's the time. And so I said, Well, he's decided he's not going to live with us anymore, so he's gone away. And Bruddy ran upstairs and laid down on the floor and cried. He said, "I'm not going to be a scientist."
So there we were, out in the country, no car, 3 miles from town. Roy and I, 8 and 6 respectively, walked the 6 miles to get groceries. When the old dry well failed, we dug a new one, making up a song in the process, 6 feet deep and 6 feet wide. Thankfully, stones were easy to find in New Hampshire.
He wanted a divorce, and the court refused to give him a divorce. And so we had to sit in this great big auditorium thing, you know, with the lawyers having the case and everything. And I can remember sitting next to your dad and putting my arm around him because I felt sorry for him that he was the one that felt that way. And he didn't have this great feeling of love for people like I did.
Roy's co-worker, Abby Cooper, provides more insight.
And I would ask him about his wife sometimes. And he, and I, you know, because I would say what I didn't like about my ex-husband. He said she was too religious. She was too religious, and then the little girl thing. That's what he kept saying. He couldn't handle the daughter thing. He couldn't handle that. He just couldn't handle it. She should have died. And my wife and I didn't agree, and he acted like there was a plug to pull the knot, but I don't think it was quite that simple.
He always wanted her to be put in an institution.
I remember Evie saying that he thought the child should be, and she should be able to devote her time to you boys and to her marriage.
My own interpretation was, and I remember talking about this with Jerry, that we both felt that Evie was a person who would always really sacrifice herself to take care of somebody else. And we thought that, we guessed that it had come from having the disabled brother, that she learned that in her family, to just be that self-sacrificing. But we both saw her that way. I think that she saw him as depressed. That's my sense of it anyway, that her early relationship with him, she saw him as a rather depressed person that she was going to help to be happy. What your dad may not have been able to handle was that the emphasis of rescue was shifted to somebody else. Your mother was focused on his happiness, and then when your sister became ill, she was focused on her instead of on your dad's happiness.
He needed someone who could devote a lot of time to him. And of course, with a child handicapped as Roxanne became, it was impossible to give enough time to satisfy everyone.
We knew that I couldn't take care of you kids alone up there, 3 miles out in the country and all that stuff. And so we tried to decide where it would go, and they wanted to help me. They would come and help me no matter where we were. And we decided that Canton would be the best place, because if we went back to Detroit, that's a big city and not so good. And we thought a little town of Canton, where we're familiar with the people and even have relatives around. And we knew about this house. We knew it was a big house and had all these 4 rooms downstairs and big enough kitchen that we could put a bed in and everything.
And so we moved to the small town of Canton, Pennsylvania. Mom's parents closed up shop in Detroit and followed us to Canton. They were indispensable, helping Mom take care of Roxanne and the big old house. Child support was initially nothing, and then only minimal. So Mom began giving piano lessons, charging just $2 for 1 hour, but often longer lessons. Despite the constant care required, Mom always found an hour or two a week to get outside and hike, or even play tennis.
The first time I saw Sissy, because of the medication she had to take, the anti-seizure medication, she had facial hair, and you know, she was very deformed, and you know, it startled me a bit, you know, when I first saw her. And I realized very quickly that that's not what Evelyn saw when she looked at Sissy. Evelyn saw her beautiful daughter that she loved with all her heart.
Well, she'd bring Sissy right in the living room, and Sissy would smile. You knew that she was getting something out of it. And the students would have their lesson, and she'd sit there smiling, and you knew that there was some kind of pleasure with that. And Evelyn knew that so well. She got her out every day in a little push cart, as you call it. She went all over with her, with all the problems she had taking care of Sissy. She was such a delightful, cheerful, happy person. I loved to go down there. Lots of times I'd go down at 9:30 at night after my kids were in bed and all my duties were done. I'd head for Evelyn's house.
I think most of the things that she did them on her own time, as long as it took. And I know she mentioned that about piano lessons. You couldn't teach a piano lesson in half an hour. How could you do that? It had to be a long time.
Play a little bit of it and let me listen again and see how you phrase it.
The half-hour lesson became an hour and a half. She would never stop a lesson till she felt she'd accomplished what she wanted to. And most children get restless after a long period like that. They'd sit right there and be patient and listen to her. And a lot of those students went on to be fine musicians.
She never was a housekeeper, and she admitted it. But things got pretty rough. I remember trying to find a place to sit to eat a meal, and I couldn't because the table was just cluttered with things.
Just very fascinated with how she lived and how she ate, and you know, kidney beans out of the can, or you know, raw vegetables, or you know, whatever. She didn't sit down and eat the traditional meals. You know, she ate only when she was hungry and only till she was full.
And lots of times she'd be up until 2 o'clock in the morning taking care of Sissy.
You know, she would have to stay up all night giving her enemas and feeding her to make sure she was getting the nourishment she needed.
She did sleep in the morning if she could, and I was always careful never to call in the morning because I figured she needed her sleep. I have no memory ever being critical because she had this child to take care of, or unhappy. She always had a smile on her face. She's really someone that could be almost a saint.
Boy, God has helped me so many times in my life. It's the only answer, there's no other way.
The night that Sissy died, it was so amazing to me because she died through the night, and most people right away would be on the phone making the necessary phone calls, you know, having someone come and, you know, pick the body up. But she didn't do that. She spent the whole night taking care of her one last time. She washed her hair and she put clean pajamas on her, and she just wanted to spend that time with her. And most people wouldn't understand that, but it was the most natural thing for her to do, that this was the last time she could take care of her. And it was just beautiful. And she called the next morning, and I remember going to the house, and she had Sissy all propped up in bed and her hair all combed. And it was just sweet because it was like her final act of love to be able to take care of her herself that night and to say goodbye to her in the way that she lived her life, you know, taking care of her. And, you know, I was there when they came to take Sissy away, and I know it was like ripping her heart out of her because that had been her life for so long.
I don't know, taking care of someone when it's all love, love, love. It's so, so special. I never felt bad about not being able to leave her. I just wanted to be with her all the time. It's like I cut in half now.
Roxanne died in 1992. Thus began the long, slow decline.
The last time I saw her was when she came out here. She was coming west after the death of her mother and her daughter, and she was going to visit her brother, Claire, and I said I wanted her to come on to California, and she came and visited here very briefly. And that's when she wasn't too well. Ended up in the emergency over at the hospital. We'd been out for lunch, and the gentleman next to her was a doctor, and he said to me, your friend's ill, we'd better call 911, so we did. But they carried her on the chair out to the porch to get better air, and that's where the ambulance picked her up. So she was in the hospital a couple of days here. And then she recovered. They didn't seem to know what had really caused it, but she was ashen and disturbed, and the doctor was sure she needed to go into the hospital.
I was starting to get a little concerned because she would tell me that she would be out hiking and she would come home, and she couldn't find her house. She didn't know. She was looking, in her mind, she was looking for her childhood home in Detroit. And she couldn't find it. And then all of a sudden, she would walk by the house and something would remind her that that's where she lived. So she, even though her memory was fading, she knew that it was.
Be late at night, she'd be hiking up in the cemetery. I don't know why, but wonder if she didn't kill herself up there. And of course, Marie always would want to feed her because your mother wasn't much for feeding herself. Ice cream, I guess she lived on.
She never forgot that we lived here on 60 North Minocqua Avenue. And it would be any time between 6 o'clock and 8 o'clock usually, not any later than 8 o'clock. In the winter, 8 o'clock, of course, it was pitch dark. And I would scold her. Now, you're not to be out. And she'd say, oh. Then she'd say, thank you. Mm-hmm. Always so kind. Mm-hmm. It was so good to see you people. Mm-hmm. And I should have been kinder to her. Mm-hmm. I really should have, but I wasn't. I was my mean Marie.
April 2003, Roy and I took Mom back to the Detroit neighborhood she grew up in.
Better walk onto another street and see her. I didn't live in that house.
Didn't you live at 16554 Blackstone Ave? Come on, I gotta connect these portions of your brain, Mom. You lived in this house.
What's the number on that house?
Which was your room, Mom?
I don't remember a thing about it.
We visited some of her lifelong friends.
About a block away, wasn't it? Do you remember where I lived? On Trinity?
No. I'm getting very forgetful about everything.
Well, that's where it goes when we get older. We're both getting up there, Evie. Yeah.
We wouldn't do that, would we? I'm going to sit beside you because... Good to forget it.
Oh, yeah, that's the kind of thing you want to forget, yeah.
Yeah. But Mom, I mean, she you know, now a trip like this, I mean, it's real overwhelming for her because, you know, it's like every day we're in a different state, you know.
How long have you been on the road?
Well,
just since Monday
morning. Yeah, we
just
left the day after.
Well, let's see. Today is September 5th, 2003. In fact, it's Brady's birthday. He's out in California. And I thought I would give a little video tour of the downstairs just to kind of show the way things were left when Mom had her accident on June 13th. It's her baby brother. Summer of 2002, that I rented a dumpster and we hauled out close to 4 tons worth of stuff out of the house. One of the things that we took out was the old stove, which always ran the risk of being left on when Mom might be cooking. So I had this hot plate modified so that all you had to do was push a button and it would only stay on for 5 minutes. This is the bathroom. I'm actually standing in the bathtub to get this shot. Over here at the sink, I had a sign up on the wall, trying to keep it straight in your head. And then also trying to encourage her to brush her teeth. This is the coat rack. This is where I tried to start the other night in thinking that I could start to pack away her clothes. And I don't know, for some reason these coats just seem to represent everything that she stood for in terms of the way she enjoyed life. And just how energetic she was and how she'd get outside every chance she could and never seemed to get cold. And if she wasn't hiking, she was in here watching TV and was just transfixed and hypnotized by the commercials. This is a calendar that I bought her this past Christmas to try to organize her day. And you can even see the final entries for June. Tuesday, Ben comes home, bread calls from California. The 11th, weed the garden, practice the piano. 12, read the Saddam book, last entry. 13th, Ben comes home. Usually it was a lot more mail, junk mail and stuff like that. There's here. There's her shawl and her sweater where she left it. And these photographs have been a little rearranged because I took a bunch of them over to the hospital for her to look at while she was there. But this is pretty much the way she had it. There's where Mom and I used to play. There's Adoration. Used to always play that. There's the song that she wrote called The Swing. A couple items of note. above the bureau in the music room. Mom's high school diploma. Day after she turned 17, she graduated.
So I'm just hoping that that this is gonna help me to move beyond. But I know I'll never get over it. I mean, I know I'll always miss her. Miss her terribly. So I'm just gonna try to do a video and try to find her letters from World War II and put them together in a booklet, and hopefully that will allow other people to appreciate who she was and how special she was.
Evelyn, lovely lady, sweet music is in her soul. She dances to the tune of love. Every day she gives of her life for love. Every day she sacrifices for love. And I am so glad to know her. She's touched the heart of me. Evelyn, lovely lady, she climbs the rocks and hills. Creation reflects the beauty in her soul. She relishes every moment of life. She may be getting older, but she's full of life. And I am so glad to know her. She's touched the heart of me. To see the look on your face when Sissy came to greet you on that golden shore where pain and broken bodies are no more. Now you can hop the stones with Sissy, climb the rocks for Brody, and hike the longest trail in heaven for Binny. Yes, you can hop the stones with Sissy, and climb the rocks for Brody, and hike the longest trail in heaven for Binny.
Remember so much of our days in Alton, and take care, give my love to Roxanne.